Hello everyone. After discussing structure and functions of DNA and RNA and the cell cycle and its regulatory checkpoints in the previous competency, now we are switching on to the new competency in this lecture series on genetics and molecular biology. I am Dr. Yogesh Pawde. I thank you all for subscribing to the channel and liking and sharing the content. I recommend to those who are not yet subscribed to the channel to subscribe and press the bell button so that they'll get the notifications of the upcoming videos in future. Now coming to BI 7.2, which deals with DNA replication, DNA repair, transcription and translation mechanisms and various regulatory factors as well as the inhibitors of replication, transcription and translation in this competency. In this competency, now in today's session, we will discuss about DNA replication in eukaryotes. The specific learning objectives of the session are: at the end of the session, students shall be able to describe DNA replication in eukaryotes. So let us see the DNA replication. What are the steps in DNA replication? There are total 5 steps and majorly there are 3 phases of DNA replication. So which are the 3 phases? Initiation phase, chain elongation phase and ligation of the newly synthesized DNA segments is the third phase. And in the first phase, there are 3 steps, that is identification of the site of origin of replication, and second step is unwinding of double stranded DNA to provide single stranded DNA which can act as a template, and third step is formation of the replication fork. Okay, so 3 steps in the first phase and remaining 2 phases are forming the remaining steps of the DNA replication. So coming to the first step of first phase, that is initiation. What is that? It is the identification of sites of origin of replication. You know, the machinery, the replication machinery has to identify the site where it has to start the replication process. So how does it identify the site where it should start the replication? So there must be something. So what is that something? There are 3 factors which enables that replication assembly to identify the site of origin, that is sequence specific DNA binding proteins, the regions which are rich in AT, that is adenine and thymine, and a specific interaction of a protein, that is O protein. These 3 factors will identify the site of origin of replication. At the origin of replication, there is an association of sequence specific DNA binding proteins with a series of direct repeat DNA sequences. There are, you know, in a DNA molecule, there are direct repeat sequences, and mostly the site of origin is present at those repeat sequences of DNA. And it is found that near to those repeat sequences, the regions are rich in adenine and thymine. A specific interaction of a protein, that is O protein, it interacts with ORI, that is site of origin, leading to local denaturation and unwinding of the adjacent AT rich region of DNA. Now you understand why there should be AT rich region, because the energy required to break AT bond will be less. If the region is rich in AT content, you know, the energy required to cause local denaturation and unwinding before the helicase actually acts on it, before the enzyme which unwinds the DNA actually acts on it, there should be local unwinding and local denaturation. When it will be possible? It will be possible when the energy requirement will be less or the process is easy enough to initiate. So sequence specific DNA binding proteins, AT rich regions and the interaction with O protein will identify the site of origin of replication. After it has caused the local denaturation and unwinding of adjacent AT rich region, now the second step is unwinding of double stranded DNA to provide single stranded DNA. In this step, there is a proper sequence of events leading to unwinding of double stranded DNA so that the single stranded DNA is produced for replication. First of all, the nicks which are produced due to local denaturation and unwinding of double stranded DNA because of association of O protein, right? So that local denaturation and unwinding will cause torsional strain and it will cause coiling and supercoiling of DNA. and the torsional force will affect replication process. So the torsional force has to be, you know, nullified. How to nullify that? It will cause nicks in one of the strands of DNA. But if those are cut or nicks are produced, it has to be quickly resealed by DNA topoisomerase. Otherwise, you know, there will be breaks in DNA and replication will not occur. So just to get relieved of the torsional force, a nicks are produced in one of the DNA strands and it is quickly resealed. After nullifying the force, it is quickly resealed by DNA topoisomerase. Repair process of the nicks does not require energy because of the formation of high energy covalent bond. DNA helicase will initiate unwinding of DNA and it allows for processing unwinding of DNA subsequently. After DNA helicase has unwound the DNA, it has separated, but there are chances that because of the complementary base pairs, the complementary base pairs may re-anneal to each other. Once this DNA helicase has, you know, continued its action along the DNA, so the separated nucleotide should be separated so that the primer gets attached to it. So how to keep them separated is the function of single strand binding proteins. These single stranded binding proteins binds to each single stranded DNA strand and stabilizes the complex and prevents re-annealing, and it will allow attachment of RNA primer to the nucleotides. And then coming to the next step in initiation phase, that is formation of the replication fork. In replication fork, there are four components. One is DNA helicase. We have just discussed about its function. DNA polymerase alpha, which has a primase activity in replication in prokaryotes, you know, there is separate enzyme that is primase. But here in eukaryotes, we have DNA polymerase alpha, which has primase activity. It initiates synthesis of RNA primer, which has length of 10 to 200 nucleotides. That is essential for priming DNA synthesis. We'll see that in the next step. Why RNA primers are required for synthesis of DNA? We could have synthesized DNA primers also, right? But here we need RNA primers. DNA polymerase delta initiates nascent daughter single-stranded DNA by polymerization. And single-stranded binding proteins, you know, stabilizes the complex and premature annealing is prevented. Coming to the next phase of replication, that is chain elongation. In this phase, before going into details of chain elongation, I think we should be aware of certain facts or concepts so that you understand the chain elongation process better. Through complementary base pairing, the order of bases in the template strand specifies the order of bases in the newly forming strand. So those are going to be complementary. The DNA polymerase delta catalyzes joining of new nucleotide to the preceding nucleotide through the formation of phosphodiester bond, and this process is known as polymerization. DNA polymerase delta first joins the correctly paired nucleotide to the 3' OH end of RNA primer. You will understand why RNA primer is required for the initiation process. Because DNA polymerase first joins the correctly paired nucleotide to the 3' OH end of the RNA primer, not directly to the DNA. And then it continues to add the appropriate nucleotide to the 3' OH end of the grooving chain, but not directly to the DNA. It has to start with addition of nucleotide to the 3' OH end of the RNA primer. And later on, it can continue. As a result, the DNA strand under construction grows in 5' to 3' end direction. So this growing DNA is, you know, growing in a direction of 5' to 3' end, while the DNA polymerase is moving along in the 3' to 5' direction. So the movement of DNA polymerase is along from 3' end to 5' end, but synthesis of DNA is occurring from 5' end to 3' end. So this concept you should understand, the movement of DNA polymerase and synthesis of nascent DNA. As DNA replication proceeds, the helicase progressively unwinds the double helix, and this DNA polymerase delta will move along the direction as the fork, move along the same direction as the fork to synthesize the leading strand. This is the leading strand, there is no breaks here, so this is the leading strand. However, the synthesis of lagging strand is little problematic because the polarity of the lagging strand is opposite to that of leading strand, and DNA polymerase can only synthesize DNA or replicate DNA in 5 prime to 3 prime direction, and the direction is of the RNA primer. So these are the concepts which are needed before we understand the chain elongation process. Now let us see what is the priming process. This priming process involves the nucleophilic attack by 3 prime OH end of the RNA primer to the alpha phosphate of the first entering deoxynucleotide triphosphate with release of pyrophosphate. This is the first step, that is the priming process, nucleophilic attack by 3 prime OH group on the new deoxynucleotide triphosphate. So this OH group will attack alpha phosphate of the first entering deoxynucleotide triphosphate, and the pyrophosphate will be released, and later on the elongation process will start. Now 3 prime OH group of the newly attached, this will attach to this after this breakage of alpha phosphate, and this will be attached here, and later on 3 prime OH group of the newly attached deoxyribonucleotide monophosphate, and it is free to carry out a nucleophilic attack on the next entering deoxyribonucleotide triphosphate, again at its alpha phosphate moiety with release of pyrophosphate. So the process will continue. Priming will occur by nucleophilic attack by 3 prime OH group of the RNA primer, and later on the elongation will occur by nucleophilic attack by 3 prime OH group of the nucleotide attached to the RNA primer. And from where the energy is coming, this hydrolysis of the high energy bond in each deoxyribonucleotide triphosphate provides the energy needed for elongation process. We know that there is no existence of enzyme which can polymerize DNA in 3 prime to 5 prime direction. Both the newly replicated DNA strands has to grow, so that both of the newly replicated DNA strands cannot grow in the same direction simultaneously. Again, the same enzyme does not replicate both the strands at the same time. As the DNA strands are anti-parallel, the polymerase also functions asymmetrically and anti-parallelly. The leading strand, which we have seen, that is the forward strand. The leading strand, that is also called as the forward strand, is synthesized continuously in 5 prime to 3 prime direction. It is the same overall forward direction. The lagging strand, that is also called as retrograde strand, it is synthesized in discontinuous manner, and in this strand the DNA is synthesized in short spurts. You can see here, after the RNA primer, a small segment, that is Okazaki fragment, is synthesized, the length of which is 1 to 5 kilobase pair. You can see after the RNA primer a short segment of DNA is synthesized, and that is called as Okazaki fragment, the length of which is about 1 to 5 kilobase pairs, and there are several Okazaki fragments synthesized, maybe around 250, and those are in sequence for each replication fork. So 250 Okazaki fragments approximately for each replication fork. Here DNA helicase and the primase, that is DNA polymerase alpha in case of eukaryotes, they form primosome. So immediately after helicase activity, single strand binding protein will attach, and the primase component in primosome will synthesize primer, and it will be immediately attached to the nucleotide. This association of helicase with primase allows the primase to get access to the template, which makes the RNA primer, and in turn allows polymerase to begin the DNA replication. When synthesis of one Okazaki fragment is completed, the polymerase is released. Here in this case, after a DNA fragment is synthesized for this primer, the DNA polymerase will be released. It will go in the opposite direction of its synthesis, and will attach to the RNA primer and will synthesize DNA fragment up to the previous primer on the same template. So the same polymerase molecule remain associated with the replication fork and forms a new Okazaki fragment. This process is repeated to form several Okazaki fragments on the lagging strands. This was chain elongation. Now there are RNA primers attached to the DNA strand. Okay, so the next step will be removal of RNA primers. The removal of RNA primers can be thought of as a DNA repair event. And when there is DNA repair, the DNA polymerase epsilon and DNA polymerase beta are the two enzymes which have DNA repair activities. It requires exonuclease activity. So these enzymes have that kind of exonuclease activity, which is required for proofreading and gap filling activity. In prokaryote, it is RNase H. Here in eukaryote, it is DNA polymerase epsilon. It recognizes and removes most of each RNA primer by specifically degrading RNA that is base paired with DNA, except the ribonucleotide directly linked to the DNA end. The first ribonucleotide of the RNA primer, which is attached to the DNA template. This cannot be removed by DNA polymerase epsilon. Most of the RNA primer is removed, but only one nucleotide remains attached. This cannot be removed by DNA polymerase epsilon. This final ribonucleotide is removed by 5' exonuclease by degrading the nucleotide at their 5' end. Then after removal of the RNA primer and the final ribonucleotide by 5' exonuclease, gap needs to be filled. The removal of RNA primer leaves a gap in the double-stranded DNA. The DNA polymerase epsilon fills the gap until every nucleotide is base paired, except for a break in the phosphodiester backbone here between 3' OH and 5' phosphate of the repaired strand. DNA polymerase epsilon had a problem here in removal of RNA primer also, and it has a limitation in gap filling function at this particular point also. So this nick is produced here, and the nick in the DNA can be repaired by DNA ligase. The DNA ligases use high energy cofactors, that is ATP, to create a phosphodiester bond between an adjacent 5' phosphate and 3' OH group. Only after all RNA primers are replaced by DNA, the associated nicks are sealed and we can say the DNA synthesis is complete. So for DNA replication, these are the major classes of protein which we required. One is topoisomerase. We have discussed the function. What is that? The start of the process of DNA unwinding by breaking the single DNA strand. Okay, releasing the tension, holding the helix in its coil and super coil form. And helicases, which unwind double-stranded DNA at the replication fork after super coiling eliminated by the topoisomerase. So single-strand DNA binding proteins maintain the stability of the replication fork by protecting it from being degraded. Then there are primases, which prepare and attach a small complementary RNA sequence to DNA at the replication fork. And DNA polymerase alpha has the primary activity. DNA polymerase, which actually polymerizes DNA, synthesizing new DNA strands, provides DNA proofreading and DNA repair functions. So DNA, for DNA repair functions, there is DNA polymerase beta and DNA polymerase epsilon. And DNA ligases, which seal nicks that remain in the newly synthesized DNA after the RNA primers are removed and the small gaps are filled by the DNA polymerase. So last function is by the DNA ligase. Coming to the three possible models of DNA replication, there is semi-conservative replication, conservative replication, and dispersive replication. In case of semi-conservative replication, we can see that one strand of each new double helix is conserved from the parent molecule and the other one is newly synthesized. So either of the strands in double helix is newly synthesized and the other one is inherited from the parent. In case of conservative replication, the parental double helix remains intact. This and this remain intact, and both strands of one daughter double helix are newly synthesized. In case of dispersive replication, both daughter double helices carry blocks of original DNA interspersed with blocks of newly synthesized material. So lot of combination and recombination occurs in dispersive replication. In humans, it is semi-conservative replication. Coming to prokaryotic and eukaryotic DNA polymerases and their functions, their major functions and their minor functions. After going through lot of literature and available resources, I could compile eukaryotic DNA polymerases and their functions in this table. There is lot of confusion amongst those literature available regarding eukaryotic DNA polymerases and their functions. But whatever is plotted here in this slide is the consensus which I could find amongst those references available. We'll go one by one. The eukaryotic DNA polymerase alpha. The DNA polymerase alpha synthesizes RNA primers. That is the main function of DNA polymerase alpha in eukaryotes. It has two subunits. One is small subunit which has primase activity and the largest subunit has polymerization activity. So it can act as DNA polymerase also. It has polymerase activity also. But its major function is forming RNA primers. And later on, it is extended by DNA polymerase delta. But because it has polymerization activity also, sometimes in some cases, it replaces DNA polymerase delta also. Coming to DNA polymerase epsilon. The major function of DNA polymerase epsilon is DNA repair. And DNA polymerase beta is specialized for basic season repair. In DNA repair category, DNA polymerase beta has very unique property of base excision repair. Whereas in case of DNA polymerase epsilon, it has both nucleotide and base excision repairs. DNA repair is the main function of DNA polymerase epsilon and DNA polymerase beta. DNA polymerase epsilon, it removes primers for Okazaki fragments from the lagging strand because it proofreads and fills gap, so it can subserve the function of DNA repair properly. So the proofreading and filling gaps is also the main function of DNA polymerase epsilon. To have a more precision in proofreading and filling gaps, it also has both the exonucleases activity, that is 3' to 5' end and 5' to 3' end exonuclease activity, which is required for proofreading. And some references say that in some cases it replaces DNA polymerase delta. Then coming to eukaryotic DNA polymerase gamma, it is very clear about that it is required for mitochondrial DNA replication and repair process. Then coming to DNA polymerase delta, the main function of DNA polymerase delta is chain elongation of both the strands. It also has proofreading activity, but only 3' to 5' exonuclease activity is present in DNA polymerase delta. So DNA repair, both by nucleotide and base excision repair, is the minor function of DNA polymerase delta. Okay, so this was regarding eukaryotic DNA polymerases and their functions. These are the additional details of prokaryotic and eukaryotic DNA polymerases. So there are many prokaryotic as well as eukaryotic polymerases and their respective functions are mentioned here in this table. Whatever I have summarized in the previous table, this table, right? Okay. So this is for additional information. So these are the prokaryotic and eukaryotic DNA polymerases, and among those eukaryotic polymerases, the DNA polymerase delta and DNA polymerase epsilon, in this particular reference, it has mentioned that, you know, DNA polymerase delta has a DNA polymerase function specific for lagging strand and epsilon is for leading strand. So this was all regarding DNA replication, and this is the literature which I have used to compile this presentation. You can refer to these references for further deeper studies. Thank you very much for watching the video. If you like the content, please hit like and share the video amongst your colleagues. And if you are not subscribed yet, kindly subscribe to the channel and select all so that you get alerts for the upcoming videos in future. Thank you so much.